Amen. You know, I'd like to welcome you to Aberdeen Light and Life Church. You know, today I've got a small bit of message for you. And you know, if you would turn your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, we'll be reading from verses 24 to 27. You know, we'll read the scripture, then we'll pray. You know, it says, do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but one receives a prize? Run in such a way that you may obtain it. And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown. Therefore I run this not with uncertainty. This I fight not as one who beats the air, but I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should come disqualified. Amen. You know, let us pray in here tonight. You know, pray for me. Pray that God will help me to deliver his perfect word. You know, God's word is perfect, but I'm not. And you know, pray that God will speak into our hearts, that God will minister to our hearts, encourage us and strengthen us through his precious word. Father God, as I come before you, my God, Lord, I pray and ask, my God, tonight, my God, that you would let it be nothing, my God, of man. But Lord, my God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, my God, that you would take control in this place, my God. That Lord, my God, that you would use your word, my God, to encourage, my God, the hearers, my God. Lord, let it be a lamp unto our feet, my God. We pray and ask in Jesus' almighty name. Amen. You know, here, as we read through the book of 1 Corinthians, you know, to understand a little bit about 1 Corinthians, you know, this was a church that was founded by the Apostle Paul approximately about 50 AD. And you know, this church was founded on the right, it was built upon on the right doctrine, on the right foundation that the Apostle Paul, that we read about, had started them off. And you know, as we read about the book of Corinthians, you know, it was a letter of Paul sending back to the Corinthian church. You know, the Corinthian church was built upon, like I said, on the right doctrine. You know, the Apostle Paul was about a year and a half after he started the church, building them up, teaching them in the ways of God, in the things of God. But you know, to understand that this letter was roughly about 3 years after Paul had departed from Corinth. You know, Paul was at Ephesus at the time, and you know, as he was writing this letter back to the church of Corinth, you know, it was about approximately 3 years. And you know, Paul, this letter, he deals with many things. You know, Paul has heard the testimony and the things that's been going on in the church. You know, the church at once Paul had put on the right foundations, built on the right doctrine, you know, has started becoming corrupt, is starting to live in worldly ways around it. You know, just like the church of Corinth, you know, like today, you know, it was a sinful, worldly world. You know, Corinth at the time, it was a coastal group. It was, you know, it had a lot of population, a lot of people from different backgrounds, different cultures. And I believe that when we read through the book of Corinthians, what happens, they started to compromise, they started to allow the worldly things in. You know, Paul deals with many different things. You know, he's heard about the division. He's heard about how they're using the spiritual gifts to promote themselves. And when they looked at their gifts, they thought themselves to be more blessed than others and many things. But you know, as we come to chapter 9, 8 and 9, you know, Paul talks about a self-denial that's needed. You know, Paul talks about here in chapter 9, he gives the metaphor of a runner running a race. And when we look into the context, it's about abstaining from things that we could have for the reason of better things to come. You know, Paul said this here in the book of Corinthians chapter 9 and verses 24. And you know, we're talking about the runner. You know, he said, do you not know that those who run in a race all run? You know, at this time, Paul talked to them. And Paul was going to give them the illustration. And Paul was going to use a runner to show the qualities that we must have as a Christian. You know, the discipline that we must have as a Christian in our own life. You know, Paul says, he was talking to him about the runner. And back in this time, there was a thing like the Olympics, the Isthmus Games, it was called. And you know, they were well informed about these people. You know, so Paul talks about the runner. And you know, he's about to liken the runner and the athlete to the Christian walk. You know, Paul says to them, do you not know that those who run in a race all run? You know, that in this race, you know, a person who had entered into a race, you know, a person who had entered into this place, they had one thing in mind, they had one goal in their mind, they had one thing in heart, and that was to cross the line well, to finish well. You know, in this race, maybe, I don't know, 50, maybe 60, maybe 100 people, you know, nobody wanted to end in 10th place. Nobody wanted 5th place, you know, but everybody wanted to finish well. You know, one of the if we look at the characteristics of a runner, one of these things that we should have is that they run wholeheartedly. You know, he says, all who run in a race, they all run. Now, how does this apply to you and me as a Christian? You know, when Paul is talking about running the race as a Christian, you know, he's talking about living the lifestyle and the purpose and the plan that God has for you and God has for me. You see, God has a plan and a purpose for each and every single one of us. You know, the Bible tells us in the book of Ephesians that we are all saved unto good works, that God has got a plan and a purpose for each and every single one of us in our life. And you know, Paul is saying this, the runners have entered into the race. You know, when we have met with the true living God, when we have met with Christ, you know, we have already been entered into this race. God has a plan and a purpose for each and every one of us. And you know, we should be like the athlete. We should have our heart set on finishing that race well, that we should run in the race that we have been entered into. You know, Paul says all the runners run, but only one receives a prize. Only one receives a prize. He says, run in a way that you may obtain it. You know what Paul wasn't saying here? Paul wasn't saying that we should try and outdo one another as a Christian. You know, it's not about where I am and how far I am in front of someone else. You know, that's not the way Christianity works. You know, but what Paul was saying is like the runner, you know, like the runner, they have their eyes set on finishing well. They have their eyes and their heart set on the goal. You know, as a Christian, we should have our heart and our eyes set on the things above. We should have the heart to finish well in the race that Christ has put us in. You know, not that I'm going to finish first or, you know, I'm going to be ahead, but, you know, if we keep our eyes on the finish line, you know, a runner, you know, he would have his heart finishing well. He would have his heart and his eyes on the finish line, that he would finish well. And you know, because he had his heart on finishing well, because he had his eyes on the finishing line, you know, his whole lifestyle would come into line. You know, the Bible says that when we look about the athlete, and when we really think about the athlete, you know, the athlete, in order to win that prize, you know, he would change his full lifestyle. He would train himself not only physically, but mentally. And he would train himself up so he was able to win that prize. You know, Paul goes on to say in verse 25, that everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. You know, this word temperate or self-control, they have self-control. You know, Paul says they are temperate in all things. They are able to abstain from things that's going to hinder them from winning the prize. You know, if you think of an athlete, you know, who is going to run a race. You know, they've maybe got a race coming up. They've got a marathon coming up. You know, and they're leading up to it and they run up to it. You know, they're training, they're exercising, they're up that hour before anybody else in the morning, they're going out for a job. You know, they're abstaining from anything that is going to hinder them. You know, when people are out there in the world, they're enjoying the sugary drinks and they're enjoying the fast foods and, you know, they're out drinking with their friends, you know, the athlete, because he has this goal in mind that he wants to finish well. You know, he has this goal in mind. He is able to abstain from these things. You know, although he can do it, although maybe it be good to the flesh, you know, he thinks about the finish line. He thinks about that goal ahead, and you know, he abstains from it because, you know, these things will hinder him from finishing well. You know, that Paul's talking about it in a spiritual sense. And you know, you think about the Christian. In the Christian walk, we have been saved by Christ, we have been entered into this race where each and every one of us has a purpose in our life. We have some purpose where God wants us to be effective for Him. And you know, we want to run well, if we want to be effective in our Christian walk, if we want to be like the athlete, if we have that mindset and running the race well for Christ, you know, we must be able to abstain from the things that is going to hinder us. You know, I want to tell you, in the flesh, would love nothing more to be one of the boys. You know, in the flesh, you know, when the boys come up, or not me, but you know, some people maybe in the past maybe had a drink problem or smoking, or the list goes on. I'm not going to name them, you know, but when they come up, you know, and you really want to do it, and the flesh comes up and you really want to go, you know, as a Christian, we must be able to abstain from these things. You know, in the book of Hebrews, the Bible tells us, and the author of Hebrews tells us that, you know, in this race, it's not just a sprint, but it's a marathon. At times it's going to get difficult, at times it will get hard. And you know, he says we must run with endurance. You know, it's a lifetime commitment, it's a lifestyle. It's being led by the Holy Spirit. And you know, in order to do this, in order to have that staying power, you know, in order to have that power to keep on going in the things of God, to keep on running that race, we must lay aside every weight and sin that easily entangles us. You see, I want to tell you, it says we must be temperate in all things. You know, that's able to abstain from things that is going to affect me in my walk or affect others. You know, I want to tell you, when we think of it, you know, there's things in your life or there's things in my life. You know, when we look at it and we think, just because it's not sin, you know, then there is right that I can do it. You know, just because it's not sin, you know, it doesn't mean it's good for me. You know, I want to tell you, I love fishing. You know, you might love golf or football or whatever the case may be. But you know, if you are doing these every single night, 5, 6, 7 hours a day, and you know, you're going out with the boys and you're having a laugh and you're having fun and we're feeding the flesh, you know, sooner or later, it's going to start to hinder us in our walk. Sooner or later, it's going to start to become a weight in our life. You see, we must look at all things, not with the eyes of if it is sin, but ask ourselves, does it hinder us or does it hinder others in our walk with Christ? You see, I've seen me at times, you know, when the boys maybe want to go out fishing and I'm looking and I really want to go out. And you know, I'm thinking to myself, I could do with going out, I can do with, you know, just going out for the day and having a bit of fun. But you know, at the same time, I'm looking and I'm saying, spiritually, I've never took the time of day to have a time of prayer. Spiritually, the day I've never took from the Word of God. Spiritually, the day I've never had that time to phone up and have a bit of fellowship. Spiritually, I need to go and read the Word of God. I need to take this time in prayer. You know, we must be able to be temperate in all things. We must be able to abstain from the things that is going to affect us in our walk with Christ. You know, we're temperate in all things. You know, Paul says, thinking of the athlete, thinking of the disciplined life that they have, thinking of how they abstain from the things of the world, how they can't just be one of the boys away out enjoying themselves and drinking and doing all these things and eating the fatty food. You know, they've changed their whole lifestyle for the sake of this goal before them. You know, he says, no, he says, when you think of the earthly, no, they do it to obtain a perishable crown. You know, these people, they would change their whole lifestyle. They would have a disciplined lifestyle. They would have their heart set on finishing well on the finishing line. And because they had their heart set on it, you know, the whole lifestyle changed. The way they think, the way that they eat, the way that they live, everything that they've done, they abstain for it so that they would be able to finish well and get the prize. Paul said, now they do it for a perishable prize. You know, think of it. What was it? What was it that they dedicated their life so much for? You know, they would get an olive fig or a fig leaf crown. And you know, at the very best, 2-3 months, and you know, it would start to shrivel up and it would probably turn to dust after a few months. You know, what was it they done it for? They would do it for nothing really, if you think about it. You know, it had no weight, it had no wealth, it had no substance really behind it. But he says, but, he says, we for an imperishable crown. Now think about this. Think about this. Think about what Jesus done to set us free to enter into this race. You know, these people entered into the race freely. I thank God once we are in Christ, we have been entered into the race. But I want to tell you, think about what it cost Christ. He had to go and suffer at the hands of men, be despised, rejected, be beaten, and all these things to die for a sinner like me. And you know, to think about it, when one day we're going to take our last breath, or the Lord is going to come back, and you know, we're going to stand before the Lord. And you know, I thank God we have the salvation, that blessed assurance in Christ. But the Bible talks about some who enter in merely escaping the flames on their back. And you know, that's not talking about, oh, that's a close one, you almost were put to hell. No, I thank God we have that blessed assurance in Christ. But I want to tell you, that flames is someone who is standing before the Lord. And they're looking back at their whole life and everything that they've put their hand to and everything that they've done for the Lord, only to realize that it's been burnt up. And you know, I heard an illustration one day. And you know, it's like this here, a man who had went and found a piece of ground. And you know, he spent his whole life doing up this piece of ground. He built a two-story house and he got everything done the way he wanted it to go. And you know, one day he was sitting on the top floor and he looked out and the bottom level was on fire. You know, he jumped out the window. And you know, he's looking back to his house and everything that he ever worked for, everything that he ever lived for has just been burnt up. But the main thing is, he's safe. He's alive. You know, but you imagine looking back to everything that you've worked for in your life being burnt up. Do you imagine one day when you're standing before the Lord? The main thing is that you have heard that. You know, come in my good and faithful servant. I thank God for the blessed assurance we have in Christ. But imagine that day, looking back and thinking to yourself, you know, all my life, I have nothing to lay at the foot of Jesus. I have nothing to offer Jesus. Now I want to hear that saying, come in my good and faithful servant, and I want to receive that crown. You know, only so I can lay it at the foot of Jesus. You know, we can never repay what the Lord has done for us. You know, we can never repay it, but I would love to have something to lay at the foot of Jesus. You know, Paul said, he says, listen, he says, but therefore, I run this not with uncertainty. This I not fight as one who beats the air. You know, Paul talks about the boxer. You know, it's always uncertain. You know, he's shadow boxing. He's trying to hit the opponent. He's trying to hit the mark. But he's never really hitting the mark because he's fighting something like that. He says, I do not run with uncertainty. You know, we're talking about the great apostle Paul, you know, who had a glimpse of, the Bible talks about the third heaven. You know, we're talking about the great apostle Paul, the blessed assurance he had in Christ. He says, well, I'm not doing this. He says, with uncertainty. He says, but I discipline my body and bring it into subjection. You know, Paul said, I do not do it with uncertainty. It's, but I discipline my body and bring it into subjection. You know, when Paul talked about the discipline in his body, you know, the word discipline, it meant to keep it under. You know, it was an old slavery term back in that days, you know, when the master would take the slave and he would discipline him, that he would keep him under, then he would bring him under subjection, that his will, the slave's will, would now become the master's will to do what he pleased. You know what Paul was saying? He said, I bring myself in to, I discipline my own body. I master my own flesh, my own body, so that I can serve the Lord. You know, we are no longer in control by the flesh. You know, as before we came to Christ, the Bible said that we were under the control and under the power of the flesh. But you know, now in Christ we have the Holy Spirit. And you know, it gives us the ability to live a life for Christ, overpowering the flesh. But you know, for you and for me, Paul says, I learn to discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest what I have preached to others, I myself may become disqualified. You know, it's not talking about disqualified from eternal life, but it's disqualified from receiving that reward that you and I can have. If we would only be like the athlete, if we would only keep our eyes fixed on the finishing line, if we would only keep our eyes fixed on the things to come, if we would only be temperate in all things, if we would abstain from feeding the flesh with the worldly stuff, casting off every weight, and if we would only run and keep focused on the things to come, if we would only live that disciplined lifestyle, you know, if we would receive that reward. You know, I want to tell you something. Paul said something at the very start. He said, don't you know that all the runners in the race run? He said they all run. You know, as Christians, we should all be trying to live that godly lifestyle. We should race for Christ. You know, this is why, because Paul said this here. He says, lest what I have preached to others is that I myself may become disqualified. You see what Paul said? He said, me preaching this to you, me telling you to live a godly lifestyle will not win me crowns. I myself must discipline my body. I must set myself discipline my body and bring it into subjection. I must run this race. I must abstain from the things of the world. I must learn to control the flesh, or else I may be in danger of losing my rewards as well. You know, listen to me. You know, many people today, we fall into the same old things, you know, because we've not got that disciplined lifestyle. You know, we don't have the power in our life to say no to the things that we should be saying no to. You know, when we look at it, you know, many people say, Lord, you know, I've got this problem, and why do I keep falling to it? You know, Lord, I want you to master it. In the Old Testament, the Bible tells us that sin crouches at the door, and you must master it because it desires to have you. You know, I want to tell you, for you and for me, we must learn to master the sinful flesh. We must learn to master the body. You know, we must learn to have that disciplined lifestyle. You know, when we look at things, you know, when things come our way, and you know, when we judge it, not as if it's sin, but if it's sin, you know, then I don't want it. But if it's not sinful, I'm going to have it anyway. You know, we should have the mindset, is this going to affect me from winning this prize? You know, is this going to affect me from losing this race? You know, the runners, you know, if they were to take from the things of the world, if they were to take the fatty foods, if they were to take all these things, you know, they would start to become physically out of shape. Physically, they would start to become tired. Physically, they wouldn't be able to run that race anymore. And I want to tell you, if we are feeding the flesh, I want to spiritually, we are going to become tired. Spiritually, the race that we have been putting in, we are no longer going to be able to run it with effectiveness the way that God plans and God intends us to. You know, for you and for me, you know, I want to be effective for God. I want to be effective for Christ. I want to be able to live that life for Christ. You know, I want to be able to run with endurance. You know, I want to have that crown that is awaiting for me. You know, I want to have that crown come in my good and faithful self. I want to have that crown so I can lay it at the feet of Jesus. You know, for you and for me, we must be temperate in all things. We must have that disciplined lifestyle. You see, the Bible said that we have the flesh we have the spirit and the flesh within us. You know, the flesh always wants to come up. You know, the flesh always wants to be in control. You know, the flesh always will have that sinful nature. But you know, you and I, by the power of the Holy Spirit, you know, by drawing from the Word of God, by praying, by seeking the face of God, we must lay it aside. We must learn to discipline ourselves in our lifestyle. You know, Paul said it, he said, lest I preach to others. Sometimes it can be me, you know. Sometimes we can all do it. We're good to preach and we're good to talk about the things of God. We're good to speak about the things of God. But Paul said, unless I discipline myself, unless I run the race set in front of me, I myself might lose the rewards. You know, me and you, we have to have that disciplined lifestyle. You know, preaching in its own won't get you rewards. It's the power and the lifestyle. You know, when we look at the Corinthian church, you know, on the right foundations, you know, built upon the right doctrine. When we really think about Paul sending this letter back to them, you know, these people had no discipline in their life. They had no self-discipline in their life. They were not temperate in nothing. You know, they were taken from, and they were acting in worldly ways. And the problem is, many people say, well, it's my testimony. You know, but I want to tell you, the people's testimony was bringing down the church's testimony. You know, and then ultimately it's Christ's testimony we've got to think about. You know, we are here to be builders for Christ. You've got to think about this here. You know, it would be all right if it was kept in the church, they would say. But you know, when we look at this here, you know, Paul was, I'm pretty sure, was 8 days away. You know, it took 8 days by boat to travel to Paul. And you know, Paul had heard the testimony of the church. He had heard about the things that was going on. He heard about what was happening in the church. The division, there was no self-control, and all these things, and the list goes on. And I want to tell you, it's important for you and for me. If we want to be effective for God, if we want to build the name up of Christ, I want to tell you, we have to live that disciplined lifestyle. You know, today, that's all I've got to share with you. And you know, I pray in some way that it's encouraged you. I pray in some way that maybe the Word has spoken to you. You know, let's pray and give God thanks for His Word. Father God, I thank you, my God. Lord, for your precious Word, my God. Lord, help me, my God, to have a more disciplined lifestyle, my God. Help me to have that attitude, my God. Lord, to observe everything and weigh everything, my God, whether it spiritually benefits us, my God, or spiritually hinders us, my God. Lord, help me to be temperate in all things, my God. I pray, my God, and ask that your Word is spoken, my God, to the hearts of the people listening, my God. And Lord, my God, let it be a lamp unto our feet, my God. In Jesus' almighty name. Amen. God bless you, church.